right, good morning again. And Miguel and I are back up here, so that's cool. And yeah, it's great. So reminds me of India. So we're going to be in Psalm 96 today.
Buenos días a todos. Bueno, estamos aquí nuevamente. Vamos a estar hoy día en el Salmo 96.
As you get there, if you want, you can flip over there in the Bible, in the seatbacks in front of you, or the Bible scripture journals that you'll see in the seats as well. If you want to go there with us, that'd be great. Today we are focusing, and the reason why we wanted to do this joint service with Lake Springs and Esperanza is because today we're talking all about the nations.
La razón por la cual estamos hoy día las dos iglesias reunidas es porque queremos hablar precisamente sobre las naciones.
This psalm that we're going to look at really hones in on the nations. In fact, there are 14 references in these 13 verses to all people, all of the world, or all nations in some way or another.
Y en estos pasajes precisamente se enfoca en esto de las naciones. Hay 14 referencias en estos 13 versos que hablan de todos, de las naciones, así que es un verso, un pasaje muy rico para hablar de esto.
All right, so I'm going to just start reading in verse 1 and go through verse 3, and then Miguel will read verse 1 through 3, and we'll just kind of break it down a section at a time, okay? Verse 1 says, "Sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord all the earth. Sing to the Lord, praise his name. Proclaim his salvation. They declare his glory among the nations, his marvelous deeds among all peoples."
Amen. Vamos a estar leyendo versos, tres versos a la vez, y haciendo la traducción, así que voy a empezar con los tres primeros, que dice en Salmo 96, del 1 al 3, "Canten al Señor una nueva canción, que toda la tierra cante al Señor. Canten al Señor, alaben su nombre, cada día anuncien las buenas noticias de que Él salva. Anuncien sus gloriosas obras entre las naciones. Cuéntenles a todas las cosas asombrosas que Él hace."
One of the things about these first few verses that really stands out to me is this first verse that says, "Sing to the Lord a new song."
Una de las cosas que más me llama la atención es este, en el primer verso, cuando dice, "Canten una nueva canción."
And when I was about 23 years old, I was a worship leader in the church.
Cuando tenía 23 años, yo era el líder de alabanza en una iglesia.
And I thought to myself, there's no reason to ever write a song.
Y yo pensé en ese momento, no hay razón para cual yo tenga que escribir una nueva canción.
Like, Chris Tomlin's got it covered.
El artista Chris Tomlin, él ya ha escrito todo sobre canciones.
So, that was until I went through something that was personal to me and personal to our church.
Y no fue hasta el momento que tuve una experiencia personal conmigo y algo relacionado a la iglesia que vi la necesidad de escribir.
And that is when I wrote a new song.
Y así fue que escribí mi primera nueva canción.
The idea of writing a new song or singing a new song is evidence that you've gone through something new.
El escribir una nueva canción es evidencia de que estás tú experimentando o viviendo algo nuevo.
That God is doing something new.
Que Dios está haciendo algo nuevo.
That God is making you new in some way. And so there's a new way to sing or a new song to sing because what God is doing in your life.
Y es una forma de ver también que Dios está haciendo algo nuevo en ti. Está renovando y sí, está haciéndote nuevo.
I just love the idea that there are things and that we're called to sing a new song to the Lord of all the earth. That he can do new things again and again and again in our life.
Y me gusta esta idea de que Dios puede hacer cosas nuevas una y otra vez en nuestra vida.
But you'll notice how he talks about all the earth, which we'll come back to at the end of this psalm. And he goes in and says, sing to the Lord, praise his name, proclaim his salvation day after day. From the very outset, salvation is a part of this song, that day after day, we are being renewed in the joy of our salvation.
Y este es un buen recordatorio también en estos versos sobre las buenas nuevas, que empieza cuando habla sobre toda la tierra, empieza en el primer verso, pero termina también en este pasaje y habla de la salvación, ¿no? Verso 2. Y esto es algo fundamental en esta nueva canción.
And his salvation is the good, the marvelous deeds, and the reason that you bring glory to him amongst all people. To declare his glory amongst all people is to declare the fact that you were once lost, but now are found. That you were once far from God, but now you're near to God. You were once unsaved, but now you're saved.
Y esta nueva, o esta salvación, es precisamente lo que hace, nos motiva que nosotros anunciemos las buenas noticias de que Él salva para que otros experimenten esta gracia.
Also, what I find fascinating about this psalm is that it really brings out the story of the Bible from beginning to end. In Genesis, I think there is this thought, for whatever reason, that the Old Testament is just about the people of Israel, and although that is the predominant kind of people that's talked about and dealt with in the Old Testament from the very outset in Genesis chapter 12, there's a promise that God is going to use those people to bless all people.
Y aunque el Antiguo Testamento predominantemente habla sobre Israel, pero no solamente se limita a eso, sino que en Génesis 1, 12, incluso es una referencia a que a través del pueblo, la nación escogida de Israel, se traería salvación a todo el mundo.
So the covenant promise that God makes to Israel is really a covenant promise that he makes to all people from every tribe, every tongue, and every nation.
Así que la promesa esta promesa que Dios hace del pacto es algo que no solamente se limita a Israel, sino que es para todo el mundo.
And so we have to look at the Bible from that lens, that this is what God is up to and what he's always been up to. He's always been up to not just working with one group of people or one tribe or through one tongue or in one nation, but he is coming for the whole world and the whole creation.
Y eso es algo que vemos que siempre es Dios escogiendo una nación para que a través de esta nación pueda salvar a todo el mundo. Ese es un tema recurrente.
All right, let's move on. Verse 4 says, "For great is the Lord and most worthy of praise. He is to be feared above all gods, for all the gods of the nations are idols, but the Lord made the heavens. Splendor and majesty are before him. Strength and glory are in his sanctuary."
Y vamos a leer los siguientes tres versos, del 4 al 6, que dice: "Grande es el Señor, es el más digno de alabanza. A él hay que temer por sobre todos los dioses. Los dioses de las otras naciones no son más que ídolos, pero el Señor hizo los cielos. Honor y majestad lo rodean, fuerza y belleza llenan su santuario."
The idea is that God is worthy of praise. And there's a contrast that the psalmist makes between Yahweh, God, and the idols.
Sí, entonces hay un could you repeat that again?
Sorry. Yeah. So there's a contrast that the psalmist is trying to make, that like there's a difference between our God, that our God is worthy, and the idols, who are unworthy.
Y hay un contraste significativo, que es que entre nuestros dioses, nuestro Dios es un Dios digno en comparación de los otros ídolos que no son dignos.
Now, the ESV, the English Standard Version of the Scripture, will actually translate that second line where it says, "For all the gods of the nations are idols." It'll actually say, "All the gods of the nations are worthless idols," as a play on the words from the very first part, from verse 4, where it says that God is worthy. And that idea is because God made all that has ever been made. Yeah, go. Yeah.
Entonces hay aquí un contraste interesante, un juego de palabras en la traducción de inglés, el ESV, se habla sobre los ídolos. que también se vuelve a hacer otra referencia en el verso 5, que es algo que no son dignos de alabar. Así que podemos ver ese contraste, ese juego de palabras entre esos dos, en Dios y los ídolos.
The thing that makes an idol worthless is the fact that it's made by human hands. The thing that makes God worthy is that by the breath of his lungs, he put everything into existence. And what you fail to oftentimes realize when we give ourselves over to worshiping lesser gods or give ourselves over to idolatry and chasing after things that will not satisfy is that we have forgotten that the creation can never be greater than the creator.
Entonces hay una gran diferencia entre los ídolos hechos con las manos y el Dios que lo creó todo, el creador versus la creación.
Any idol that's created by human hands isn't better or greater than the human being in which created it. God created us and formed us into his image, and so we are not as great as him, but we are just a little below the angels, the Bible says.
Entonces vemos nuevamente este contraste entre los ídolos, aquellos que fueron creados, creación versus el creador, aquel que lo creó todo, y hay una gran diferencia.
This is what makes our God so worthy of our praise. This is why he is worthy and everything else is worthless.
Y esto es la razón por la cual Dios es tan digno y los ídolos son tan indignos o que no valen, porque obviamente hay creación versus creador.
We will chase after lots of good things. We will chase after lots of things that make us happy or bring us joy or cause us to almost give ourselves to it, like almost bow down to it and worship it because we want it so badly. And yet it's just a product of our own creating and a product of our own desires and a product of our own minds and a product of our own hands, and we have to realize that there is a God that we are the product of his mind and we are a product of his making and we are a product of his creation, and that is who we should worship.
Entonces hay una gran diferencia porque los ídolos o las cosas que podemos tener como ídolos, las cosas que son producto de nuestra imaginación, de nuestros deseos, de lo que pensamos que nos van a ayudar, pero no son dignos, mientras que nosotros somos producto de la creación de Dios, de la imaginación de Dios, del amor de Dios. Hay un gran contraste nuevamente entre la creación versus las cosas creadas, ¿no?
And so that's where we go. Says, ascribe to the Lord, all you families of nations. Ascribe to the Lord glory and strength. Ascribe to the Lord the glory due his name. Bring an offering and come into his courts. Worship the Lord in splendor of his holiness. Tremble before him, all the earth, and say among the nations, the Lord reigns. The world is formally established, and it cannot be moved. He will judge the peoples with equity.
Y versos 7 al 10 dice, oh naciones del mundo, reconozcan al Señor, reconozcan que el Señor es fuerte y glorioso. Den al Señor la gloria que merece, lleven ofrendas y entren en sus atrios. Adoren al Señor en todo su santo esplendor, que toda la tierra tiemble delante de él. Digan a todas las naciones, el Señor reina. El mundo permanece firme y no puede ser sacudido. Él juzgará a todos los pueblos con imparcialidad.
So the call is to come and worship, to come and fall down before this creator and awesome and mighty and powerful God, and ascribe to him and worship him and cry out that the Lord reigns. Now the idea is that the Lord is king, that the Lord is reigning in your life, that he is supreme, that nothing else can sit on his throne except for him.
Amen. Amen. Y la idea es que adoremos al Señor, que reconozcamos al Señor, que lo adoremos y lo pongamos en el centro de nuestra vida, porque él es digno de que lo adoremos.
But this is a call for all the families, for all the people, for every tribe, tongue, and nation. I'm pretty sure this is what John was thinking about as he's writing Revelation. And he says, I looked up and saw a great multitude that no one could number from every tribe and every tongue and every nation on earth. And they were bowing down before the throne of God saying, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty.
Yeah. Y esta seguramente es la visión que tuvo el apóstol Juan cuando estaba en la isla de Patmos, cuando vio un gran pueblo que no se podía ver el número, y una gran nación y todo, y los ángeles adorando a Dios, diciéndole, santo, santo, santo es el Señor.
What I think is so true, and what we must understand is that when anyone, no matter who they are, no matter where they come from, no matter what their race, no matter what their gender, no matter what language they speak, when they come to a place where God sits on the throne of their heart and they cry out, the Lord reigns in my life, they enter into this beautiful kingdom of heaven.
Por eso es que creo que cualquier persona, no importa de qué nacionalidad sea, cuando viene y reconoce a Dios como su Señor y entra en una nueva relación con Él, porque está reconociendo al Dios Creador y Dios hace una, tiene comunión con Él.
And I think one of the most fascinating things about this verse is how it talks about how the Lord is going to come and He's going to judge with equity.
Las cosas creo que se habla aquí especialmente es cómo Dios va a venir y va a juzgar con justicia.
That the invitation is open for all people to come and cry out that the Lord reigns and cry out that the Lord is King of our life. That this is an invitation, but God is going to come and He is going to judge, and He's going to judge equally based on if we have made that choice, based on whether or not the Lord does reign in our life or not, based on whether or not the Lord is King of our heart or not. And He's going to do that with equity or equality. He's not going to look at you differently because of the color of your skin or because of any other mark or any other thing. He is going to look at everyone according to if they have accepted the invitation to put Him as King over their life.
Y cuando Dios venga, Él va a venir a juzgar con justicia y va a venir precisamente a ver si lo hemos reconocido como el Dios, como el Rey que Él es, y para saber precisamente a aquellos, no importando qué nacionalidad sea, qué raza, etcétera, o lengua hable, es solamente va a mirar eso, si lo hicimos Rey o no de nuestras vidas.
And I think it's one of those things we need to really truly embrace, is that God wants to give everyone an opportunity to be a part of His family and to be a part of His kingdom. And we should be, as people of His kingdom, equally excited about extending invitations to anyone and everyone so that we might all be together here on earth as it is in heaven.
Entonces Dios quiere que nosotros seamos parte de su familia. Él está haciendo esa invitación para que podamos ser parte de la familia de Dios y podamos también extender esa invitación a otros que están lejos de Él, pero cerca de nosotros.
So let's keep reading verses 11 through 13. It says, let the heavens rejoice, let the earth be glad, let the sea resound and all that is in it. Let the fields be jubilant and everything in them. Let all trees of the forest sing for joy. Let all creation rejoice before the Lord. For He comes. He comes to judge the earth. He will judge the world in righteousness and the peoples in His faithfulness.
Amen. Y estos últimos versos del 11 al 13 dicen lo siguiente. Que los cielos se alegren y la tierra se goce. Que el mar y todo lo que contiene exclamen sus alabanzas. Que los campos y sus cultivos estallen de alegría, que los árboles del bosque susurren con alabanza, delante del Señor, porque Él viene, viene a juzgar la tierra, juzgará al mundo con justicia y a las naciones con su verdad.
I love how this mimics the creation story in Genesis 1. It begins with the heavens and moves to the land and the sea, and then the earth and the trees and all of creation. And then it like culminates with all of creation. You hear that in verse 1 from the very beginning, that this is about all the earth crying out and singing for joy and praising God and singing a new song. That when we lift our praise, when we begin to sing as a part of God's creation, we're singing with the rest of His creation. That just in being a tree is praising God. Just in being a bird that flies around and chirps is praising God. Just in being just the sun and the stars that come out each day, like, is praising God because they're responding to His creation. They're responding to His command. We, as part of His creation, should join in this song.
Esta es una hermosa referencia a Génesis 1, donde se habla y de cierta forma como que imita, digamos, un poco, porque empieza con la creación de los cielos, de la tierra, el mar y los seres que se crean en cada uno de esas áreas, y cómo toda la creación, los árboles, la naturaleza y todo le da gloria, alabanza a Dios. Y eso es algo que también nos invita a nosotros también, a que solamente el árbol, por ejemplo, con solamente ser árbol, ya le está dando alabanza a Dios. Y de la misma forma nosotros, como Dios nos ha creado, podemos también darle alabanza a Él de acuerdo al propósito que Él tiene para nosotros.
So as we put a close on Psalm 96, I want to draw our attention to something that's real and present with us today.
Y mientras ya vayamos llegando al final de este Salmo 96, quiero traer a tu atención algo que es importante para nosotros hoy y ahora.
So from the very beginning, God has been on a rescue mission, not for one group of people, but for all people.
Del principio de la creación, Dios ha estado en una misión de rescate, y no solamente para un grupo de personas, sino para todo el mundo.
And we, together today, despite any differences that we might have, we come together today because the way God chose to do that was by sending Jesus to die on the cross for the sins of all people.
Y nosotros, siendo de muchos diferentes contextos y trasfondos, venimos aquí precisamente porque tenemos a Jesucristo, quien hizo posible que nosotros podamos ser parte de la misma familia.
His body is broken and His blood is shed in order that He might start a new humanity.
Porque su cuerpo fue partido, su sangre fue derramada para que por él, por ese sacrificio, una nueva humanidad sea creada.
A humanity that is diverse and beautiful from every tribe and every tongue that can come together because we are brothers and sisters, because what we have been bought into and what we've been adopted into is the family of God through the blood of Jesus Christ.
Y esta realidad es de que, siendo muy diferentes, podemos nosotros nuevamente de todas las naciones venir a ser una familia porque hemos sido adoptados, comprados por la sangre de Cristo, y podemos tener esta nueva relación, esta nueva comunión por Jesús.
And so a day like today for most of us in the room should be very special. It should get us excited. Because today is a day where what God decided to do through Christ and dying for the sins of all people, that we might be a part of one family and live in unity and harmony with one another for eternity, is coming alive on earth as it is in heaven.
Amen. Yes. Y la razón por la cual tenemos que estar emocionados es porque a través del sacrificio de Jesús podemos nuevamente ser, estar unidos, estar en comunión por lo que hizo, por el sacrificio de Jesús.
It should excite us because it's like pulling the veil back and opening up the window to peek into eternity, even if just for a couple hours.
Así que debe emocionarnos esa realidad de que Por gracias al sacrificio de Jesús tenemos acceso precisamente a la eternidad y podemos tener esta unidad gracias a Jesús.
To the day in which we are all together for eternity, and we're all bowed down before the Lord God, our Maker, who reigns in our hearts, in our lives, and we declare with all the angels and all the saints, holy, holy, holy.
Y bueno, esto hace que nosotros podamos estar, ser parte de esa familia, que podamos todos juntos como familia unida en Cristo decir santo, santo, santo es el Señor.
So as we come to the table this morning and take communion, there are tables two up front and two in the back.
Así que mientras venimos y recordamos eso a través de la comunión, hay dos mesas ahí adelante y atrás para tomar la comunión.
I pray that we'll take the bread and take the cup and see it for what it truly is. That it is the price that God paid to adopt us and to make us brothers and sisters together.
Y mientras tomamos el elemento de la comunión, recordemos que fue el precio que Cristo pagó para hacernos familia, para hacernos hermanos y hermanas en Cristo.
Not just for to bring us together, not just for today, not just for, you know, June 30th, 2024 at 10:30 a.m. in Holly Springs, North Carolina, but that it is a purchasing of our lives to adopt us into His family, that we might be brought together for eternity.
Y esta sacrificio, este precio que se pagó no solamente es por ahora, sino es por toda la eternidad, para poder estar siendo uno, una familia hasta la eternidad.
That this broken body and this shed blood is what makes heaven possible.
Esta sangre derramada y este cuerpo partido es lo que nos hace una sola sangre, una sola familia.
And this broken body and this shed blood gives us the opportunity and us the chance to experience that heaven right here and right now as we worship together.
Y esta sangre derramada y este cuerpo partido es lo que permite que podamos ser una familia aquí en la tierra como en el cielo, aquí y ahora.
So may we come to the table thanking Him for just His amazing, amazing grace that unifies and makes us all family.
Así que vengamos a la mesa con alegría y con agradecimiento, sabiendo que esto hace posible que tengamos esta gracia asombrosa, maravillosa, a través de Jesús.
So in just a second, I'm going to pray and then invite you to the table where you can take the bread and take the cup and take it back to your seat. And whenever you feel led, just take it. We're not going to guide you through this time. This is a time for you to reflect and spend with the Lord. So take it whenever you feel ready.
Así que mientras vas y tomas los alimentos de la comunión, puedes regresar a tu sitio. No voy a guiarte cómo hacerlo. Tú tal vez ya sabes y ya hemos estado hablando sobre esto. Así que regresa con esto a tu lugar y puedes tomarlo ahí.
But when you take it, remember that He loves you, that He died for you, that He has saved you, and that He saved everyone in this room, that we might be a part of His kingdom here and forevermore.
Y cuando lo tomes, puedes estar seguro de que Él te ama, que Él murió por ti, y que Él quiere hacerte parte de su familia desde ahora hasta la eternidad.
Let's pray.
Vamos a orar.
Father, we thank You for Your love and Your mercy.
Padre, te agradecemos por tu amor y tu gracia.
God, we thank You that we can come before You and bow down and worship.
Te agradecemos porque podemos venir a ti y adorarte.
That we have a song to sing of Your glorious truth and Your glorious love and Your glorious sacrifice on the cross that unites us together as brothers and sisters.
Y que podemos cantar una gloriosa nueva canción, o una nueva canción sobre tu glorioso amor, sobre tu glorioso sacrificio, creación y amor que tienes por nosotros.
God, that we are a product of your creation. We worship because you are worthy. And no one and nothing else can get on a cross or will get on a cross for us. And so, God, we praise you because you're not a worthless idol that we've contrived of our own mind and built with our own hands.
Y te adoramos, Dios, porque tú no eres un ídolo que se hace con las manos y que sea producto de nuestra imaginación.
But you are a God who formed us out of the dust.
Pero tú eres un Dios que nos formaste de la tierra.
To reflect your image here.
Para reflejar tu imagen aquí.
To reflect your design and your beauty and your majesty to the rest of the world. And every human being, every person, from every nation, from every tribe, and every tongue, reflects the beautiful image in which you bestow. And so, God, we worship you because we could not create that. We could not form that. We could not make that happen. You alone, God, you and you alone can speak words into existence and make these truths possible. So God, we come to your table in reverence and in worship. With hearts humble but full of praise. Thank you for Jesus. It's in his name we pray. Amen.